and then you die. I think that's actually a little worse than running out of ammo, because at least when you run out of ammo,
sixes and sevens is in the lead for his team, just because of the fact that he's sitting back covering his team.
No, high carnage.
He has the most kills, but sixes and sevens is the one who's sitting up top. I don't know if you noticed, he was in the spawn covering his team to give them an opportunity to push.
Right, but high carnage is also, you know, doing very well. 14-0, sixes and sevens. While yes, he does have the high ground, high carnage is, you know, racking up kills, thus allowing players on his team like Celtic Rose right there to get underneath the bell.
A lot of unanswered points.
Oof. Flute Squad.
90. Are they going to drop a 100 bomb on us? Can we hit the triple digits? 10 seconds left. Someone push up there. Get it. Someone found a secret spot. We got a point. We got the points going up. They have found an angle to hit that bell.
I don't see a triple drop, though.
So close. Oh. You teased me, but you didn't get it.
Teasing us. They like teasing us tonight.
Wow.
I'm at a loss for words.
We're going to switch it up and try again.
Motorpool, definitely proven to be the harder side to win on,
yep.
Or at least not get into a big hole.
Yeah.
Now, with that being said, do you think that Mayhem will kind of just hang back like we saw in the first round of Hell's Bells and just kind of cover the bell, not making it very hard for the other for Flute Squad to score?
I mean, do you
want me to repeat my question?
No.
I mean, you were. I know you're engaged in the chat.
I'm trying to figure out what Flute Squad can do to come back from this. There's a lot of ground to cover. They almost had 100 points on them. They've got too much time that they're focusing on killing and not enough on ringing the bell.
I want to say thank you to Camage47. They at least like my beard. Say I need to tuck behind my lips. It's hard. It's still a little short. But thank you for supporting my beard.
Kona Girl calling out for her shout out for Team Mayhem. You're going to get the win. So keep the shout outs going, because this Team Mayhem is really showing that they are running this tournament. They are going to set the tone for the rest of the match with this next Hell's Bells as we started off here. If they can rack up another set of points, there will be no coming back from it.
Well, I mean,
I'm curious to see if they do what they've been doing in the past and just hold their ground. They've got players moving up right now, so I don't know if they're just going to try and sit back or really try and put some more points on the board.
I mean, as it's sitting right now, it's a 70-point difference. So really all Mayhem really has to do is they just have to hang back.
What do you think, folks? You think folks at home in the chat, you think we're going to hit 100 bomb today? You think someone has that potential? I really hope they do. I feel like getting out of hand here. I want to see it. I need to see it.
We've
got a lot of people who can do it, but it's going to require them to work with their teammates to hit it.
You know, I'm going to go back to my opening statements. Communication.
Yep.
It's playing a big factor here right now, and you know, I know we didn't really touch on it too much, but it's having a strategy. Come into it. If you hit a brick wall, change it up a bit. Just don't give up.
You gotta be able to handle the adversity. You can't sit there and do the same thing over and over. When you break mentally.
Tutu! I just saw a pink tutu.
When you break mentally, okay, so first off, if you're losing to the tutu, you're already you already lost the mental game. I mean, that's putting salt in the wound.
The pink tutu.
I don't like losing, but if there's a tutu involved, I'm going home, folks.
Pink tutu worn by a man.
Nope.
You know, for the folks at home, it may sound like we're poking fun, but, you know, we actually really enjoy the fact that this man has enough courage to wear a pink tutu.
And he wears it well.
He wears it with pride.
That is... I don't think I could ever say this in a sentence before, but that is the most masculine tutu I've ever seen.
Did I just hear you correctly say that that's a masculine tutu?
I mean, I don't know when I'll ever be able to say it again.
That's very true. So for the folks at home, I know you're watching this. It's a really stagnant half right now. I was expecting a little more out of Flute Squad. You know, actually, the amazing... Yeah, I expected a little more out of Food Squad. So, Food Squad's getting there. Their communication is just broken.
Nope.
Not
going to happen.
Mayhem did exactly what I thought they were going to do. They built up the huge lead. They're not really going for the bell, and they're just waiting for Food Squad to expose themselves.
Yep. Hunters and the hunted. They are just waiting in the bush to strike. They've already got the point secured. Now you just got to keep the lead there.
I mean, if the points stay this way, it will be a 70-point difference.
Sixes and sevens, 8-1. Air Glider, 5-2. 6-3 Celtic Rolls, 4-4 High Carnage, 4-6 Tulio. A lot of kills moving around. They are just holding down the fort.
Oh, there we go. Oh, so close. He had, you know, Food Squad had the right idea.
This is literally going to be a 1-point game.
In all my times of iCombat, I honestly have only seen a 1-point Hell's Bells game once.
But see, that shows you right there the kind of level of competition that you have to face. You're not going to be able to play an entire match and not score a point like that. These players aren't going to let you. They're not going to let you in.
That's very true. You know, we said it earlier. Give an inch, take a mile. Flute Squad, I think, gave 2 inches. Thus, Mayhem took, like, 2 miles. They just ran away with that one. Mm-hmm. Yes, I know that was a cheesy one, folks. Don't give me any more crap.
Cheesy one-liners. Ah! Congrats to Team Mayhem for really setting the tone for the Hell's Bells. A lot of points scored. A lot of bells. A lot of bell rings.
In the first portion.
In the first one alone.
Yeah.
But you can't really put up a point like that unless you have a good strategy.
That's very true.
I'm really anxious to hear what their team's got to say about this, because you can't put up a point like that without having a solid strat behind it. So, Jennifer, let's pick their brains a little bit and see what they think.
Once again, we're with the winner, Mayhem. And in this mission, was there anything different from any other mission?
This mission, we tried to get out in front right away in the first game. We had problems with that the first few games. So we came back, and we pushed real hard and destroyed them the first game. And so the second game, we were able to hold back and try to just secure the win.
And is there any areas that best fitted you guys?
Our plan that we've been running the whole time has been working perfectly. No one's been able to answer to our plan right now. So if it keeps working, keep going with it. So,
in being a member, who do you think is the MVP of your team so far?
The MVP right now would have to be... I'd probably have to say High Carnage. He's still pushing really hard, making sure that we are all doing what we need to be doing, but also being out there and helping everyone else out and doing his job out in the field.
Okay, good job. It's great to see you back. And back to the announcers.
Do not fix it if it ain't broke. You heard from them. They are running the same strategy until someone can stop it. If you don't have an answer, You're not going to be able to beat them. The teams that are going to be able to dethrone them are the teams that are going to be able to pick through that strategy. Tactical advantage for Team Mayhem, because no one knows what to do about it. The team is just owning this tournament. We are going to kick things off with Team Pew Pew and Red Bananas. They are 3 minutes 45 seconds into this match with no points scored. Red Bananas got a few kills on the board, a little here and there for both teams, but they don't seem to have any real points being scored. Ah, there we go. Team Pew Pew dropping a few points on the board. Unanswered, unhit, with the back sweeping it up! No points, unfortunately able to score. CJ coming out of the shadows like a ninja. Pushing up for his team. Unfortunately didn't get the kill. Get the points, excuse me. He got the kill, didn't get the points, but for this game type, you gotta get the points. Red Bananas need to push. We had an entire Pew Pew team in the spawn, dead, with no one to cover. An 8-point lead to Pew Pew. Still have yet to get an answer from Red Bananas. A lot of skulls over on the red side of the field. CJF showing how tough he can be, pushing up, getting those kills that he needs to secure some points. but no one behind him to answer with a bell ring. A couple points on the board as they show up to this first match with 2 minutes and 30 seconds left. 18-3 in favor of Pew Pew. Florence 6-1. 9-2, Havoc. Got a good cover and a good push. Good communication, red team. Figuring it out, pushing ahead, getting a few more hard-earned points to try and shrink the lead. These players need to focus more on that bell than they do the kills. It's important to keep your team alive, but lives do not win this match. Kills do not a winner make. You need to ring that bell. to 13, 1:35 left in this match. Pretty neck and neck. Honestly, the teams that are here are pretty even. They have a pretty good aggressive push. I see a lot of bodies in midfield. We haven't seen a lot of bodies midfield in the last couple matches because we get some solid pushes and then a pause. We get a press and a pause, a press and a pause. But I'm getting a lot of people midfield. Red Bananas pulling away with the lead, 23-18 with a minute left. Can they keep it? 7-4, EJN. Turnkin, 8-5, keeping his team going. CJ, 11-6, keeping his teammates alive. They got the well-deserved and well-needed points. They got, oh boy, here we go. Here it comes, there it is. Now we get it moving. Dropping, unfortunately, but putting a couple points on the board. 30 seconds left, and Red Bananas have pulled away with the lead. EJN sticking some more points on the board before dropping herself. Green team needs to answer. Looks like the firefight there over at half court. Ten seconds left, 46-22. Was close, but they managed to pull away with a solid win for the first side of this match. Final score of 54-22 in favor of Team Red Banana.
Hey, folks, I'm back. Sorry about that. So, as Cody was, you know, giving you guys a little play-by-play, Pew Pew, you know, not the strongest demonstration that they showed earlier, in my opinion. Red Bananas, really strong push. You know, the thing that I liked that Pew Pew did right there was they actually proved that you could get points on the board from, or I'm sorry, Red Bananas proved that you could, I'm all over the place.
That's okay. So are the teams. that was a pretty close game. First, Team Pew Pew had a pretty solid lead in the beginning there. They had a pretty good aggressive push at the beginning. They got some solid points on the board, but Red Bananas found a way to counter it and really sink them in a hole.
That's very true.
And we're off with the next round of this match. Switching sides, giving the players a different angle to shoot the bell. Different push from both sides here. Each side is a little different. You're going to have a little different props and a little different angles from each side.
Oh, look at that.
Whoa!
Pew Pew was getting points, and then Red Banana guy came up behind him. Didn't really know.
I didn't think he knew he was there.
I think he did. I don't think
he didn't realize care.
What team he was on. He was like, I'm just going to go.
I don't know you, but I want to ring the bell. I live for the sound, must ring the bell. 7-7. This game is going to be pretty close. If you're noticing, pushing from the spawn, we're getting a lot of the same time pushes. This is making firefights pretty crazy here in the beginning. We're getting a lot of players at the midfield at the exact same time. You're not really gonna see a point gap when you got people like this. We've got two red, two green vests hanging out halfway. But unfortunately for Team Pew Pew, Red Bananas is going to keep scoring some much-needed points.
And, you know, Pew Pew has to drive Red Banana's out of the bell, and then they have to win by 32. It sounds like an easy task, but honestly, with the way that this tournament has been going, easier said than done.
Yep, absolutely. I'm going to say it better myself.
EJN there underneath the bell, getting some Red Banana love.
Bringing some serious points. You cannot let your opponent sit under the bell like that.
You know, and she's actually kind of using the same little sauntering strategy.
A little bit of frustration out there.
That's very true, yeah.
You can't, regardless of what's happening on the field, you got to keep your head right. You got to keep pushing. Not every push is gonna go the way you planned it, and so you gotta keep running back. EJN being merciless with these points that she is putting up on the board, 105 points, with Turkin supplementing that bell ringing with 7-1 KD.
You know who EJN is reminding me of right now?
Who's that?
Kenjutsu.
Kenjutsu. So,
I mean, she's just sauntering there. Look at that. She's underneath the bell. She's not ringing it. But she's just in the open, killing, and now she's underneath the bell. We finally have a triple score on the bell.
You know what it is? These players have no fear. Kenjutsuji and EJN, they have what it takes, and they don't care what you're gonna do. But you're not gonna answer it. I'm gonna sit there and I'm gonna ring the bell. You wanna do something about it? You wanna do something about it? Do it. But they don't have fear.
Yeah, and
120 points!
I'm seeing right now that, you know, Pew Pew is really, really frustrated. Red Bananas right now, they're just kind of proving a point. Like, this is our game.
The statement that they are trying to make is that this is our game, you're going home. They just are unrelenting.
I'm at a loss of words right here.
Woo! 139 points at iCombat Madison. Have you ever seen that? Is that a thing? Is that real? Did that just happen?
Wow.
Nope. 15 seconds left in this match with a secured victory for Red Bananas.
Pew, pew, pew.
Sticking in there to the end, but unfortunately they just could not match the level of intensity.
And EJN worked hard, and now she has to tie her shoe.
I got some bells to ring. I ain't got no time to tie no shoes.
Until after the match.
Shoes? I got bells to ring. I don't need shoes.
You know, and so the nice thing about the Madison field, it's turf. So EJN, she is from Waukesha. I personally have seen her play in her socks before in Waukesha.
Yep.
So, you know, I would not have been surprised if her shoe would have flown off in the middle of that game and she would have kept going, because she proved that she was willing to do what it takes.
Yep. And this team really secured that victory with an incredible win. I want to hear from the victors for dropping that incredible, incredible score countdown on us.
I believe it was close to 200, freaking out by the triple digits,
and they buried me. I didn't expect that at all. So with all that being said, let's go down to the field and hear from the lovely Jennifer.
Once again, we're here with Red Bananas. During this mission, what led your team to victory?
The fact that I told them, I said, we got to be patient. We got to wait for the bell, get open, go after the bell, and keep them back. Don't let them get pushed up, and don't let them draw a borderline right where they did. And they did a great job. They even pushed up faster than what I wanted.
And what was different from this round than any of the rounds you've played so far?
We worked together as a team. And Havoc and his man and his crew, they put up a fight. I mean, I'm sweating pretty good. We put up a fight when we just came out on top.
Okay, thank you very much. Good job. And back to the announcers.
Holy cow. I've never seen a point total like that. That was incredible. I really have to give it to him. CJ, my man, quite the victory.
Yes. So we're going to get rolling with our next one. As the viewers at home will know, that voltage is down one player.
Unfortunately, one player just wasn't feeling well. So this is a game you can't you can't lose by not pushing it. And being down a player is going to be an extreme disadvantage.
Yes, and Voltage, their Voltage back is against the wall right now, and this is something that they did not need.
Nope.
Now,
cannot plan for something like this.
Luckily, they do have this particular game to their advantage because it's not about the kills.
Nope.
So what they can do is they can get into their areas. They can keep Live for the Tactical Batman out of the bell, which is
despite
what
disadvantage.
Oh,
getting some
board. That was nice by Slayer 76 protecting the bell at all costs.
Yeah, absolutely.
He almost took a
barrel of the face.
Almost,
right,
not
in
quite,
his beak.
But almost.
No. And you know what? They got some solid points on the board to set the tone. Now it's 6-6. When you're down one player and you're holding the field, you've got to really keep pushing. You got to get those points. You got to hold it. I don't think they're aware of the score right now. You need to check the score when you're running back from respawn so your team knows. Pushing it out. Voltage pulling ahead. 4 points.
Yeah, and this is the Voltage that, for the viewers at home, that
this
are from the Waukesha field.
These are the players that we see really showing you what they're made of.
Right.
Now, hopefully we'll be seeing their fifth player back later in the tournament because playing with a one-player disadvantage in this tournament with the level of players that you're going to play against, you can't have it.
That's very true.
It's going to make this game so much harder than it needs to be for the team.
Oh, there's Hold My Batman doing a little 360 on the bell. I think he's putting a little show on for the folks at home.
Absolutely.
Folks, how did you just feel about that 360 hit and out of the bell?
We need a name for it.
I mean, it's not a 360 no-scope.
Batman gained some points, and now they are dropping some kills. Can they hold their short lead, though?
I'm not too sure.
Batman sneaking up behind the tires, trying to hold down the tower so no one can earn any points.
Oh, and there's Aclem doing his thing. Bobbing and weaving, getting underneath the bell. Runs out of ammo, but not before he puts up 9 shots on the bell.
24-17 with Batman enough. Spending too much time covering, not enough time a bell a ringing.
Oh, ran out of ammo.
They got a few points on the board, but Batman is coming back.
All because Voltage had those 3 skulls. They are now up by 13.
37-24.
And down by 9. Down by 9. Ooh.
This just in, folks. We've had a player been pulled from the field for jumping over props. This is going to give your team a huge disadvantage. Brooks 2965.
That is something that Voltage
did not need.
Adding
insult to injury.
Oh.
Down a player, taking one more. You can't let your team down like that.
Yeah.
Very unfortunate. 6 seconds left. 51-28. 56-28.
Yeah,
going to Team Batman. Wow.
Wow.
This just goes to show you how serious these field judges take this tournament. You're not going to cheat. You're not going to get away with that. You need to be the best that you can be within the realm of the rules. Not very often do we see players get pulled, but unfortunately, Brooks, you can't be jumping over those props, man. I don't know what happened, but you're making the game harder than you need to, man.
And as you can see right there, Voltage's team captain, Aclem, is not happy.
Can they come back from it, though? That's what's important.
Honestly,
as big of a mistake as you make, can you make up for it? It's not what you did. It's what you do to fix it.
Yeah.
So
we will see
what kind of competitor this player can be.
And I think Live for the Tactical Batman realized what had happened while they were on the field. So, some more facts about what is going on. Voltage, if they do pull off this win, he will be available for the next round. So Brooks is only out for this match only.
Down another player again?
So they're going up against a squad of five with only three people. Their backs are
numbers
against
the
wall.
You're not going to be able to pull a win off with the numbers.
Yeah, Voltage's backs are against the wall. I've seen them actually come back from bigger deficits in the past. But, you know, folks, this is exactly what makes the draft tournament so interesting.
Yep, it makes it very difficult. So the problem with what happened this last match is it's very difficult to push up the bell. You're not going to get points in health bells unless you push up. It's very difficult to push up in this field because of the fact that the bell itself is open, but your path to the bell is very covered. It makes you think as a player about how you're going to strategically maneuver yourself around to get positioned to win the bell. Unfortunately, he was caught jumping over a set of sandbags. Well, maybe a smaller prop, unfortunately not allowed due to the rules, and you're really going to put your team at a disadvantage.
Yeah, I mean, so as of right now, what's probably going through Live for the Tactical Batman's players' minds is Voltage is down two players. Let's just rack up the points. As you saw, Aclem right there, kind of doing the hold my Batman move with the 360 point shooting.
Batman with some elegant slides. 45-2-2. 3 minutes left in this match of Hell's Bells. Team Voltage. One player of their three alive, two now.
And it's the Clem brothers. Aclem is the only one alive. But he takes the advantage.
Not going down without a fight.
He took the advantage of everyone and Live for the Tactical Batman having to respawn to get some hits on the bell. But as I'm now noticing, Live for the Tactical Batman, they're kind of hunkering down. Not really going for the bell too much.
They don't have the bodies. Voltage just does not have the bodies to put on the field. They literally have one person playing at pressing at a time, and by the time they get to the bell, they're dead. They get too many people covering it.
Yeah.
There's no way to come back from this. I truly believe that we have the highest skill level of players in this tournament and the best competitors for the sport, but when you only have three players against five,
That right there, I don't know what was going through.
I think that they are calling it, folks.
Yeah, I think Voltage threw in the towel. I mean,
racking up a few points.
Live for the Tactical
there.
Batman is still going at it. I'm not entirely too sure what's going on. Slayer76 seems to be the only one on Voltage still out there. I don't see
another 100 bomb, but I mean, when you got three people,
it's gonna happen.
You can put up those points.
I mean, this is tough. It's really tough.
You gotta give it to Team Voltage, though. They would not go down without a fight.
That is very true.
They stuck through the match no matter what. Every time I saw one of those Aclem brothers and Slayer respawn, they would push through regardless of what happened. So they would push through as soon as they spawn. They would sprint to the field.
Well, they wouldn't sprint because you can't sprint.
So it's a bit of a bitter taste left in your mouth when you walk away with a loss due to the fact that you just don't have the numbers.
So folks, what we are being told right now is that Slayer76 is the only player on Voltage that is still out on the field.
He lost the rest of the team, and you can't do it with one. One player does not a team make, and unfortunately, Team Tactical Batman really was giving their opponents no mercy. Very good job for pressing their objective and holding down the fort. And they were able to pull away with the win.
Right. I mean, it's sad to see a team like Voltage go down like this, but, you know, I know they will regroup for the next tournament, and they will come back even hungrier than they are right now.
That I feel are the most hungry players that play for the
sport. That's very true.
I've met a lot of players who are confident, who are aggressive, who love the sport, keep pushing no matter what. They truly understand the sport, and they're a real force to be reckoned with.
That's very true.
I think it's a bit of a bitter taste to lose due to sheer numbers, but I know for a fact that they'll be able to regroup and be the best players. That's pretty unfortunate.
So we do have an interview from the winning team. So we're going to cut it down to Jennifer on the field, and she will have the interview for you.
All right, you guys dominated that round. What type of strategies did your team have?
Well, we had three people going for the bell, two of them defending, one going for the bell. We had our other two players going out to the sides, trying to trap the other team inside their base, so we'll have a huge advantage over them.
Did you use any type of areas to do this?
I would say we used the environment, basically, to protect ourselves from not getting shot, and I guess that helped us a lot.
And did you have any struggles during this mission?
I would say people not really following, but hey, it's whatever. We still won, and we had a great time out there.
You guys did come out top, so thank you, and back to the announcers.
What's important is they had fun, you know?
Right.
For a difficult game like Hell's Bells is, it's important to keep your spirits up and not give up. It's so hard to score even one point that you got to enjoy them when you get them.
That's very true. You know, Voltage stuck with it. The cards were stacked against them. They did the best they could with the odds that they were given.
But unfortunately, they are done for this tournament. We're going to go ahead and give you a quick update of the bracket so far for this tournament. We've got Enterprise and Mayhem going to be facing off here pretty quick in round three. This loser bracket is going to be pretty interesting coming up. Those two top two teams are really the top dogs now, but I want to see who the undercard is. Flute Squad and Red Bananas, Live for the Tactical Batman, and Madison Trauma will all be duking it out here in round three to see who will earn the right to face off against their upper-level competitors. We're going to see a lot of teams that later on in this tournament are going to be facing the same people, and I want to see what kind of strategies they're going to run based off of what they did before to now.
That's
very true.
You can't
do the same thing you did before, because now your opponents, they know what you're going to do. For me as a competitor, when I play the sport, I'm going to watch everything you do. When I die, I'm going to walk back and figure out where you go. So pretty much, I'm going to learn as I go. So that's really what gives me the edge in this competition.
Right.
So.
But real quick, you know, we're progressing through this tournament pretty quickly, I would say. We just want to take a quick break real quick to again, you know, bring up our sponsors. Elements Massage, GameStop, Benvenuto's, KMA Bodily, Great Lake Systems, U.S. Army, again, you know, Without all these sponsors, this would not be possible. You would not be seeing the topsy-turvy tournament that we are witnessing right now without, you know, the help of all these great companies.
A lot of the prizes that these teams are going to win tonight were donated by these sponsors. So a lot of the hype that's going to come with this tournament, it's going to come with some pretty good perks. And these sponsors who gave us the opportunity to give away such good prizes. So thanks again to our sponsors for supporting us, donating, keeping this tournament as exciting as it's going to be. And so, like I said, thank you very much for all you do.
And let's not forget about those Badger tickets.
Absolutely. Got to represent the Bucky. The next couple matchups are going to be pretty interesting. We've got a lot of teams that you've seen so far that are going to be facing some of the lower bracket teams are going to have a tougher time because they're fighting to stay in.
That's very true.
You gotta come in with every match with the mentality that this could be it. You're going to go home if you don't show the competitors what you can make make happen. So lower bracket, it's going to be a lot of insanity, a lot of players that are going to do some things that they aren't normally used to. So a lot of the players that are sitting back, they have the accuracy to show that they're marksmen.
They're
going to have to change it up. We're going to see a lot of different strategies that aren't really going to reflect some of these player stats. So we've got a lot of players out there that have some pretty incredible stats in terms of accuracy, their win percentage, and their KD. Uh-huh. They are players that always win. They hit their mark, and they don't die. And
that's so very true.
You might need to get out of your realm of pulling up some. you're gonna have to deal with those deaths. You're gonna pull out some things that you're not used to, and you're gonna die because of it. So you gotta get over that.
And folks, just to prove our point, we're gonna bring up some stats real quick. These are the stats of the next two teams that are playing. Enterprise and Mayhem, still neither team has taken a loss, which is surprising. And as you can see, Sixes and Sevens, again, happy birthday. He's out there with a 19.2% accuracy.
I genuinely believe that he is going to be the MVP for his team due to the fact that he's sitting Overwatch looking for Enterprise. However, Selvo, man's dropping some kills on us. Every match, he shows up with a kill count that just it impresses all, and it's usually what wins it for him. These teams are both very competitive and very, very well skilled. The chat is loving Team Mayhem, though. Wow. I cannot get over how much these folks at home are digging the Mayhem train. They cannot handle what Mayhem is putting out. Enterprise, you need to answer what this chat is saying. You need to show these people at home that you can really show up. Team Mayhem, kind of the top dogs of this in my opinion, the top dogs of this tournament right now.
As of right now, Mayhem, yes, I would say they are favorited to win.
Absolutely.
We all saw it when they went up against Red Bananas that they hit a brick wall in the first half of that team deathmatch. Swap sides, came back out. They tweaked their strategy, and they were able to take the win. Now, granted, it was by two, but they were able to get the win out of Team Deathmatch.
Now, this competition, this matchup itself, it's going to be worth a lot. So I'm pretty sure both teams are going to come out pretty aggressive. But what Mayhem has been doing throughout this whole tournament tonight, they're very under control. I'm genuinely impressed that this team is – so a lot of players are going to do the spray and pray tactic. They're going to run out. They're going to shoot. They're going to do a lot of running around, and nothing real organized. It's total chaos, but when you don't know how to handle chaos, you don't know how to defend it. There's a lot going on around you, so you don't know which way to defend and which way to go. Now, Mayhem is a little bit less of a random killing machine. They are definitely calming down. Their first match was shaky. They figured it out. Haven't really face someone who can answer what they're no one's really picking up what they're putting down.
No team has really had an like you're saying, no team has really had an answer for the pink tutu.
The confidence there.
I
don't see any real fear in those man's eyes. Especially the old man over there, their old birthday boy. Whew.
I mean, would you say that Mayhem is now less Mayhem?
I see what you did there.
Hey.
That's clever. That's pretty good.
Thank you.
All right, the next game type we'll be playing tonight will be Sniper. It's going to be a very difficult game to play due to the fact that this is not a game that you want to panic in. So we'll have a short video here for you to better understand a little bit of the rules for the game.
This is Mission Sniper. It's a 4-minute mission. Team start in the motor pool or the officer's quarters. Each person will have 50 health per life in unlimited lives. Each weapon is set to 50 health, meaning one hit kills. Each player will have to respawn in their starting location only. The overall team score is an average of each individual sniper rating. The team at the end with the most points will win.
We might be having a little bit of a change here tonight. We want these competitors to really show you what they're made of. So you got a lot of games to throw at you. There's a lot of different styles of games that we're going to be playing tonight. You saw a couple of them, which were pretty kill-based. Hell's Bells, very chaotic. You got to unload on that bell.
Right. So the games that we saw so far tonight, you know, Hell's Bells and Team Deathmatch, organized chaos.
Yep.
Or organized mayhem. No, I'm trying that way too hard.
I think you're a little biased there, my friend. I think I know who he's rooting for.
I want some of his birthday cake.
I guess so. The rest of the games that are on tonight are going to be a lot more skill derived. So we're going to have to pretty much completely change up a lot of the kill strategies that these teams have been doing, because you need to hit your objective now. You're going to be under control. We're going to be playing here a quick video for our actual next match, which will be the Whack-A-Mole game. So,
this is Mission Whack-A-Mole. It's a 4-minute mission. Teams start in the motor pool or the officer's quarters. Each player will have 100 health per life and unlimited lives. Weapons are set to 50 health per hit. That means the players will get shot twice before they die. They will have to respawn in their starting location only. There are 3 domination tubes placed on the map. One is located behind the truck, another one is located underneath the bell, and the final one is located inside the first floor of the clock tower. Teams must shoot the tube that is illuminated to score. Tubes randomly illuminate at an increasing interval. The team with the most points will win.
All right, folks, so like the video just showed you, the rules for this one, there's 3 tubes out on the field. So with the strategy that I personally would do, I would have one person at each tube with potentially 2 rovers, you know, going in between. One tube will randomly become active. The first team that gets to that tube and shoots it will be scoring the point. Now, this one is going to be chaotic because these tubes are going to be coming at you quick towards the end.
You don't know when it's coming.
You really don't. So you can have one tube just locked down.
Now,
and it won't come up for like quite some time. So the other team could potentially have a lot of points. Like Camo again right there just got the first tube, scoring a point for Enterprise. But
whacking that mole!
6s and 7s, the birthday boy! Came back and got tied it right back up.
This is a game where if you push onto a tube, you can keep answering the phone when your opponent's called. It's a lot of back and forth. There are 3 tubes, so ultimately the goal is to hold 3 tubes. When I personally play this game, there are 2 strategies that I win. I, like you said, send one person to each tube and send 2 rovers to float back and forth to the tubes that your opponents are starting to push. However, 2 is better than 1. I, a lot of times, like to put half my team on one tube, half my team on the other. Let them take that last tube. You got 2/3 of the tubes on the field, you're more likely going to score those points. Now, granted, it is a bit of a random killing machine due to the fact that you don't know what tube it's going to be.
That's very
true. You got to keep pushing. So it's important to hold down those tubes. 6s and 7s holding down his own. Mayhem, 3-1 with 3 minutes and 40 seconds left in this match. Small lead, but as the tubes change, this game could get out of hand a little bit. Kills overall, not super impressive. We got High Carnage dropping 6-1 for his first death of the match. We've got Bell Tube currently active with no one available to defend it. 3-2.
Well, no, the Bell Tube was taken by Enterprise right there.
You got, when you get the lead, you got to hold those tubes down.
That's very true. Clock Tower is now available. I don't know if anybody's over there.
So are they leaving it?
I think the main carnage is going to be over toward behind the truck with 6s and 7s, yep, and the bell tower. As you see 6s and 7s right there, he was protecting the back of the truck. He died, but he also took a potential Enterprise score with him.
Enterprise pulling another truck tube under their belt, scoring another point, bringing it to 4-3 in favor of Mayhem. Pretty close game, 2.5 minutes left in the match, and this is anyone's game. No one's digging that bell tube. Clock tube going to Team Mayhem. I'm surprised that tube is not changing back and forth. As the clock tower, that is the most contested part of this field, and no one wants to give it up. You gotta hold that tube, because that building is, that's the building to hold.
Well, and strategies throughout this, as I'm saying, sixes and sevens back there getting the truck tube. He's holding his own tube. But you do bring up a good point about the clock tower. It seems like every game so far this tournament has utilized the clock tower to a big advantage. And now Enterprise really doesn't want to go for the clock tower, thus allowing Mayhem to come out to a 8-3 lead. I'm actually astounded. Like, they were using the clock tower so effectively earlier on. I don't know if what they would be changing.
This is definitely a game that you can't fall behind. So a lot of games that people get buried under a pretty big point deficit, you can come back if you have a pretty good push. This is a game you can't score until the tube changes.
Right.
So you can't let these tubes go uncontested.
As High Carnage just scores a bell tube.
Casually, too. He didn't seem to be too worried about that.
He didn't seem to be too worried, but at the same time, as the timer is getting smaller and smaller, mission ending pretty shortly, he did kind of have a sense of urgency to get the point before the tube switched.
Yeah. 45 seconds left in this match. 11-3 with the truck tube was active, but Mayhem managed to pull it.
Taken right away by the birthday boy. You know, I'm not even going to call him sixes and sevens anymore tonight. I'm just going to call him birthday boy.
Old man.
Nah, I'm not going to say old man. I mean, he's only...
Well, sixes and sevens is my guy. I got to give him some passes.
Right, but if you call him old man, my birthday's coming up soon. Are you going to start calling me old man?
I got to call him old man because he's got 15 kills and most of the tube caps for this match.
That's very true.
You can't be that successful in this game and not have me poke at you. Say something. very good effort by Sixes and Seven and his team. 16-7 by High Carnage, 6-2 Celtic Rose. Team Enterprise trying to hang in there with some pretty decent kill spread throughout the match, but they could not get a grasp on the tubes. They didn't hold them down enough to get a good structure to hold their own, but you can't really fight a team that doesn't really have any fear.
That's very true. The thing that I've noticed throughout this entire tournament, Mayhem really hasn't been showing a lot of fear.
Nope.
Like, they get their backs pushed up against the wall, and they punch right through it like Hulk.
Dropping a Marvel. Don't you bring in my superheroes in this. I'm about as nerdy as they get, so you're going to bring a Hulk into this.
I brought the Hulk into
this. Things are going to get crazy.
I know.
We're going to go ahead and kick things off here with another round of whack-a-mole. Teams will be switching sides. Tubes will remain in the same place. And we're going to do the same kind of strategy. Now, Enterprise is really going to have to pick a couple of tubes, and hold them. You can't let your team fall behind and not hold these tubes down. These tubes are gold. You need to secure them. You can't shoot them when they're not available, so you got to be there ready for it. You got to be waiting, and you need to know that your teammate is going to score that point as soon as it pops up. Like I said, you fall behind. This game is very structured, so you can't really fall behind.
Yeah, and what I'm seeing right now is Enterprise Camo again. He's getting the high spot in the guard tower so that he will be able to, guard the truck that he can as best he can, but unfortunately that strategy doesn't really help him when it comes to capturing the tube.
Well, it's 1-1 right now, so it's 1-1. It's anyone's game. Clock tube open going to Team Enterprise, bringing it up to 2-1. Still a close game, so it should be pretty nuts going on from here. 3 minutes left and we are still neck and neck. Can Mayhem continue to show the level of skill that they have been throughout the rest of this match? I think they're just holding their own, honestly.
You know, and unlike a lot of the games, you could sit back. This is definitely one where Mayhem cannot afford to sit back. The only way that I would personally sit back is if you are trying to keep Enterprise from scoring points and just covering the tubes, but you gotta react quick when the tube that you're covering is active.
You can't be afraid to come out of cover to shoot that tube. A lot of times I'm seeing these players sitting by these tubes, but they're afraid to move out of cover. You can't be too careful in this. You gotta take those chances.
Like you see right there, Camo again. He could have gone back when the bell tube became active, but he knew that Six isn't birthday boy. I almost said his username. Six and the Sevens was hiding behind the truck, leaving his tube. Camo again came around, got Sixes in the back, and then went back and actually captured the bell tower.
Very, very close game. Mayhem still holding their lead, but Enterprise is starting to figure it out. Selvo has just not been showing up tonight.
Well,
in the second half of this tournament. He's been the player for that team that's really been dominating, and he's just not pushing what he needs to. Very, very good player, but like I said, you're not going to be able to answer a team that has a definitive strategy. Minute left, 5-3, still in favor of Mayhem. Only one person down on Team Mayhem Enterprise, over half their team. Pretty much their whole team. Hanging out in the spawn, not able to push their tubes.
Yeah, it's... You gotta push. And...
Uh-oh. Selvo getting the four serious points that they needed. Can they finish this? 30 seconds left?
I don't know.
Are they going to be able to pull off this wind?
They got to get the bell too, which is being covered really well.
There we go.
Oh.
5-5. There we go.
And Pink Tutu makes pushing an appearance.
It up.
Well, you can't get the bell too. But Six and the Sevens, the birthday boy. Gives Mayhem a one-point lead.
That man does not want to let that tube go.
You know, he found his spot. He was happy there. He was like, it's my birthday. I turned 40 today. I'm just going to sit here.
Now, if you notice, Team Mayhem had a pretty definitive strategy. They had people responsible for a tube. You had them moving to their tube, securing it when it popped, and covering it. Team Enterprise, they got some serious points in that, but they had people all over the field. You gotta stick to your responsibility, and you gotta stay with your respective teammate to really cover the area that you wanna cap. And if you do not stick with your teammates and stick to your responsibility, your team strategy is gonna fall apart.
Yeah, I couldn't have said it better myself. Mayhem right there showed what they were made of.
Continuing to dominate this competition.
Right, they won that one by 11.
11.
11.
So it's a pretty good indication of which team is dominating this tournament. So we've heard from him a couple times. Jennifer, let us know a little bit about what this team is thinking as they progress further in this bracket. So
I hope it's the birthday boy.
Once again, we're with Team Mayhem. And what made you win that mission?
Sixes and Sevens really stepped up for us this game, and he's been playing well throughout, but this game especially, he stepped up. But I'm going to have to say it's because it's his birthday today, so shout out to him for his birthday.
And I know that I've talked to you before about how your team won and stuff. Is there any struggles you've been having?
Not really. We've been working really hard to push and be aggressive the whole game. That's what we've been doing, especially this game. We won because we were so aggressive the whole entire game. We never let up.
And did you try any new areas this game, or were they the same?
We tried to have more people push for the clock tower. It was a little bit easier then, because when you have the clock tower, it was a lot easier to get that middle spot, but also then it was just able to control the whole map. So that's how we basically got it done this time.
Well, thank you. It's great to see you once again. And back to the announcers.
This team cannot be stopped. We've said time and time again that clock tower is going to be the place to be. You need to hold that down to cover the map. And they've said it how many games in a row? We held it and we won the game because of it.
Well, so, you know, I'm kind of interested to see how if Red Bananas and Flute Squad are able to do the same exact thing.
Can they push it?
I don't know.
I think if they pull the clock tower exactly like the team did, if they get that clock tower, they're gonna go ahead and pull away with. They need the clock tower.
I don't know. That truck tube has seemed pivotal for this one, which Red Bananas is already done. They've already taken the first two.
Team Mayhem is feeling the love in the chat right now. Got a lot of love for their opponents too. Team Enterprise, very good game. People at home are loving the match that you just played, so good job on your match progress so far. Now, back to the current match of Red Bananas and Flute Squad, tying it up 1-1, 350. Overwatch sitting up top, trying to cover for his team so that they can get those points. Not a whole lot happening. Clock tower tube. Pretty well covered, able to secure the second point for Red Bananas. Let's see what the rest of the teams can do with their tubes.
I mean, the nice thing that Flute Squad has going for them right now is the only one on Red Bananas that is able to capture points is CJF. Of course, as I say that, like the entire Red Banana team comes back. But the clock in this game is not that pivotal. As of right now, it's proving to be the truck. And that's just due to the fact of the randomness of the tubes. The clock tower, it's there, but it's being, so far, truck and bell.
Absolutely beautiful push by Team Red Bananas there. We had one person capping the tube, immediately doing a 180 to cover his retreat, and that is why they are leading currently 4-1. Cannot push alone. Superior in numbers. Pulling away with a 5-1. A lot of the points that they're getting, they're doing as pairs. They're working together. A lot like the team that we just saw, everybody had a responsibility. You knew what you had to do. If your job is to hit the tube and not kill people, you better be shooting that tube. If your job is to kill, you better be making sure that your teammate gets to that tube. You gotta push past and do it. And that's exactly what I saw. I saw a suicidal strategy where they ran straight through, covered their teammate, and got the tube. 6-1, holding their own. They're not letting their opponents get the tube. Falling behind in time, so you're not gonna have a whole lot of time to really gain these tubes back.
Yeah, it's just amazing. You know, Red Bananas back up against the wall. They're another one that's refusing to quit.
Nope.
Flute Squad as well. You know, I don't know.
I think they're having a little bit of a trouble figuring out how they're gonna take these tubes. That is the biggest issue that this team is facing right now. They're doing a very good job pushing, but they just can't coordinate a strategy that's going to gain them the ground that they need. CJF and Turnkin from Red Bananas.
Oh,
really
holds
down
the
kill.
There's a player from Flute Squad on the stairs and a player from Red Bananas underneath.
So close to shoot him. I can't take this.
Oh, but what you saw right there was the truck tube came active and... 30 seconds, clock tower, DJ, captures the Turnkin gave up a spot to go hit it. CJF beat him to it, but, you know. Well, maybe you don't, but. By the truck. All in all, this is a very close game, and that's exactly what I expected out of WAC. A close game. With the first round going to Red Bananas, with a final score of 11-2. Now, what will be interesting to see is if Flute Squad is able to bounce back from this loss and pull out a victory. Maybe they push Clock Tower a little more. Maybe they push Bell Tower. Maybe they just leave the truck alone and focus everyone. Or do they have one person that is sitting back there protecting the truck? I don't know. I'm not on the field. I'm just speculating my own thoughts right now. So, it's a nice shot. I really like the fact that this Madison field has that artillery piece. It's an actual artillery piece, by the way.
Absolutely. Actually, before I forget here, I would like to go ahead and point out the fact that
there's another man in a tutu.